Before we start with the main tutorial video, I'd like to tell you that about the wiki that I'm making. This wiki goes with this tutorial. It contains a lot of information, all the useful links, also the GitHub for this tutorial, GitHub for the first tutorial that I ported to 1.18. Various downloads that you can find here. Some information that I've found which can be useful when porting. This is all about porting, and then this is the tutorial itself. So for every episode, so you get a link to the video and then explanation for that video with basic, actually the same info that I give in the video, but then in a more textual format. So I recommend if you, as a reference, you can look at this instead or in addition. It's up to you. This time I provide both a wiki as well as a tutorial video. And now on to the main video. Hi, this is MC Jetty for a new episode of my 1.18 modding tutorial. And in this episode, we are going to make the last block before we go over to something else. Yeah, first we're going to add this render effect, and then we're going to make this one, which is a block that will use power generated by this, and it can do various things. So it, and also the model is a bit special. You can interact with it without the user interface. So yeah, that's what we were going to do today. So the first thing we want to do is to add a new entry for our generator in this file. So we will make a new block called the generator. It will have an item as usual, and it will have a block entity. However, since it doesn't have a GUI, it will not have a container. So we don't need a container for this one. Okay, so let's start by copying the needed things. So we have the generator block. Let's start with that. And let's also already copy the other one, and I will explain them both. Okay, so now if we do the right imports, everything should be fine. There are no more errors. So let's go over the block. First, if you could see the demo, hold on, let me show you this. So you know how in every, you see every block in Minecraft, if you look at it, it has an outline. You can see the outline. And we want the outline to correspond to the shape of our block. And you see how, in our case, our block is smaller. There's a small area here because there are these buttons here. So we want our block shape to correspond to that. And if we place it elsewhere, that shape has to also rotate. You can see the black outline around the block. That's what we are trying to do here. And that's what is being done here. These are the our block has six orientations. It can be faced six ways, and for every orientation we have a block shape. For example, for the shape where it's facing north, we start at 0.0.2 to 1.1.1. So there's a gap of 0.2 in front in at the north side. Okay. So again, we have a tooltip. Here we actually get the shape. So depending on the facing property. So in this particular case, in our power generator, we used the powered property. However, in this one, we will use the facing property, which is also a standard property from vanilla, which is the direction property, and it has the six possible direction values. And we also have a get default state, get state for placement, I mean, which places the block according or to our nearest looking direction in the opposite direction. So this is to make sure that our block, that the player can place the block depending on how he's looking at it, how he's placing it. That's a convenient way to do that. So this is the shape according to our property. So like to explain this again, this block has two block states, powered and not powered. This one has two block states, powered and not powered. This will have six block states for each of the six directions. We make a new block entity, so we also implement entity block. We have a ticker which only works at the server side. We don't want to tick at client side. And then we have a use, and we also had a use in this, but here we wanted to open the user interface. In this one, we want to interact with the front side. So what do we do? First, we check that the block is generated, that's safety. We get the direction we clicked on from the block hit result. And we check the current property value for facing. And if these are the same, that means we clicked on the face with the buttons on the interesting face. So that's the first test. Then we get the result on that face where we clicked. So there are four quadrants that we are interested in. So we get from the hit result, we get the location, and that location is in contains the world position. So we need to subtract the position of our block. So that's what we do here. And then we have, this vector, it's a 3D vector. It contains an X, Y, and Z. It's in world space. So that means that depending on the face that we click, its other components from this vector that we're interesting to compare. So we want to compare to two components to make it easier to find out in which part of the block we hit. That's these tests. So depending on the orientation of our block, we get the right coordinate from our hit vector. So if the block is facing north, we need to get 1 minus the x, and for the other coordinate, we need the y coordinate. So that's how we do this. It's a bit complicated to see why this is, but I actually found out these values by trial and error, but you can probably reason about it too, but I like trial and error. It works. Anyway, once we have these coordinates, these are two-dimensional coordinates on the block, on the face of the block that we hit, we can compare it with these to know what to do. So we have three possibilities. Either we click on this section and then we toggle the collecting button. So, and collecting is a field in our block entity. Otherwise, we click on this and then we change the generating function. And in the final case, we have to check the item in our hand. And we check if it is a block item. And we set generating block on our block entity. So those are the three things. There is one quadrant, the remaining one that we don't use. So that's basically our block. Then the block entity itself. Let me explain a bit about models. So in our tutorial up till now, we made, if you go look here, loot tables, let's close this. So we have our four ores and the power generator. Those are block states. So these are simple. They have one variant each. For each of these, there's one variant and they refer to a model. The power generator is a bit more complicated because it is a multi-part model. But in the end, it will also refer to various models here. And these are all, for both the ORS and the power generator, these are static models. They are predefined, they are in the JSON. They don't change in game. They are static models. We also want a static model in this case, but we are going to not make it in JSON this time, but in Java. And that allows us to do some things that you cannot easily do in JSON. For example, what we can do in with our generator is to right-click any OR into that slot, and it will be made part of the block of the model at runtime. So that's something that you can do with block with baked models that you can't do with JSONs. But it's still a static model. So once it's generated, it remains generated. It's not something that renders dynamically all the time. So the special effect that we will in this tutorial also add to the power generator is not static. That's something dynamic. I will show you that later in this tutorial. But first, let's go to this. So in order to support this kind of baked model, you need a way to communicate the various states that our block entity is to the baked model, and that's done with model properties. So to clarify that, whenever you press this, if you click here, in our block entity, the generating property will change, and the baked model will be notified and regenerate the static data. Same for this button, and same for the OR that you can right-click there. That's the generating block. So these are Boolean properties, and this is block state property. And actually generating, that's used to light up this panel to indicate that it's actually doing something. There are a few static values here. These could be put in configurations. These are the actual values. So these are properties, but they don't contain a value. The actual values are here. These correspond with these model properties. Then there are some internal values, which we will explain later. Okay, so here's the capability part. So for items, we have three capabilities this time. The reason is that just like a vanilla furnace, we want items to be extractable from the bottom and insertable from the other side. So we have two different item handlers, and there's one combined. So let me explain how that works. So in the get capability, if some other block asks what's the item handler capability for our block, we check the site. If the site is zero or null, I mean, the API says that you're supposed to give an internal item handler representing the entire block. And that's why I make a combined item handler for that. I will show you how that's made in a moment. Otherwise, if the site is down, we return the output item handler, and otherwise the input item handler. So this is a case where you have different item handlers. So we have input items, which is a 5-slot inventory. And we have an output item handler, which has a 1-slot inventory. The combined item handler, so we don't have a separate variable. So here we have separate variables for that because we need to be able to access them quickly in our block entity. But we don't need to access the combined item handler. That's only for exposing outside. And it just takes that something from Forge, and it takes the two other item handlers. But I also make sure you cannot extract or insert in it. It's read only. That item handler, by the way, is used. Yeah, there's nothing in it. It's immediately. Let's break that one so items don't go away. and cheat in some ingots. So let's... So if you sneak... Yeah. The one probe was able to show the complete inventory, both inventories as it were, for the input and output, because it the one probe uses NVLL for get capability, so it gets the combined item handler. There's also an energy item handler because we accept energy. So if you go check here, we actually accept energy, so we can receive energy. Yeah, and then there's a few getters and setters like these. These setters, these are correspond to the values of the buttons. So if they are pressed, we want to send, so this is server side, so we want to notify the client that it needs to do something. That's why we do a send block updated in these cases. Set generating ores, by the way, these are called server side from our block here. Also set generating block is called from there. And it will first check if the block state that we get is actually an ore. We only accept ores there. Now we have the tick method. So if collecting is true, we check collecting ticker. That's because we don't want to collect items every tick. We have a delay, which is 10. So every 10 ticks, so that's 2 times in a second, we try to collect items. And collect items, I will explain in a moment. So if we are generating, we call generate ores. And we return if we did actually do some work. And if this is different from actually generating, we change it and we call a client update. You don't want to do client updates all the time because that's expensive. So we actually only do it when there's a really a change so that we can update this front panel. That's the reason for that. So collect items, we have an axis aligned bounding box. So this is basically a box. We cache that because we don't want to calculate that every time. If it's null, we create it. We create a new axis aligned bounding box from our block position. And we inflate it with 1. So it's actually a 3x3x3 block around our position. That's where we will collect items. Items on the ground are actually item entities. So we, from the level, we get the entities of class item entity in our box. And we only want item entities. So this is a predicate. It's a lambda that gets the item entity and it returns true if it should be included in our list. And we will only want item entities that are ingots. So after getting this list, we iterate over it. And for every of these, we try to insert it in our input items. This is a helper from Forge. It is a generic insert item that doesn't take a slot. It just tries to insert the item into the item handler. And it will return the remainder, what it couldn't insert. If the remainder is empty, so everything was inserted, we kill the item entity. Otherwise, we change the item entity so that it contains less. So we will reduce the item entity. So that's how collect items works. So generate ores. If there's nothing to generate, so if this is empty, this is not the case for these two, then we return false. If there's not enough energy stored to do one operation, then we return false. Otherwise, we go over all input slots. And for every input item in there, we consume energy. We copy the item. We shrink it with 1. And we return it, we put it back into the slot. Make sure to make a copy. You are not allowed to actually modify the item that comes from getStackInSlot. If you go check this API interface, read these warnings. Always read the API documentation. Item stack must not be modified. So what you need to do if you want to change it, so you make a copy of the item, you make the change, and you put it back like this. That's how you do it. We do generating counter. And this is counter is used to track how many ingots we already collected, consumed. And after 10 ingots, we can generate an ore. We also set are we generating to true so that we can return this. Again, we insert our item, but this time in the output item slot. If we couldn't insert it because, for example, it's full, we spawn the remaining in the world. So our block, I can actually demonstrate that because if you look, go look now, there are 7 diamond ores in the output slot. Let's change the focus to iron ore. Let's just take some ingots. Look, you see how it spawns them in the world because it has no room in the output slot. That's basically how this works. And spawning an item in the world is easy. You make an entity item at the right position. You set the pickup delay to make sure it's immediately picked up by the player. Delta movement, in which direction it will start moving. You can randomize this and add fresh entity. Yeah, so that's basically, there's then everything related to the model. This is also important. So we have our 4 properties here, but that's not enough. You need more than just these 4 properties. By default, when you have a block entity and you have data that you keep in that block entity, by default, that data is not synced to the client. The client doesn't automatically get that data. So that means that these values, we don't actually have client-side by default. And also we don't need these ones at the client-side, but we do need these ones because our block properties depend on them. So to fix that, well, let's first check this is for the capabilities. Let's first check our save and load. So we have save additional and load like in the block entity, but some of this, so we split in a separate method, save client data and load client data. So basically, and actually, this is something I forgot to change. Let's fix that. We want this to be put in the info tag, so that our loot table will remember that value. Okay. Let's do it like this. So that's basically the same as what we did here. In load, it's basically the same. So that's because we want to keep that value when the block is broken and when the player puts it back. And actually, let's even go further. We also want to put these in there. So let's fix that too. Let's do it like this. So when we call save client data, our info tag will be there. And this one should be put in there. We also want to keep that. Same here. Okay. Okay. So that's better. So basically, the important thing though is we have save additional, and we have what we need at the client we put separate. Same with float. What we need from the client we put separate. And then we have four important methods which you need to understand. So there's get update tag, handle update tag, get update packet, and on data packet. Get update tag, handle update tag pair is called whenever the client receives a new chunk it hasn't seen before. The chunk is loaded. So the first time a chunk is loaded, these will be called on all block entities. So that means that we have a chance. Get update tag is called on the server. We save our client data, so we will actually. This is, we also need to make sure that the client data is present. Let's actually do it different. This is, we need to do it like this. And we mix. So yeah, this is better. Save client data is responsible for making the info tag and filling it. And save additional will reuse that info tag, which is it knows it now present, so it can safely use it. So onto this one. Yeah. So this is called server side, and it will save, make a compound tag containing data useful for the client the first time a chunk is loaded. On the client, this is called and with the tag, and we have load client data. That means that our block entity will have the correct values for generating, collecting, generating block, and also actually generating. Okay, get update packet on data packet is used when a block update happens on the client, a block state change, or an explicit notification of a block update from a server. So this happens, the first two happen only when the chunk is loaded, and these happen after that. But it's basically used for the same purpose. You also need to be able to get the data from the server to the client. So get update packet, it will call this method, which is a convenient method. If you go look at it, it will actually call get update tag for you. So it will make a packet that goes to the client containing what we put in save client data. Then when that data packet arrives on the client, so this is called server side again, and this is called client side, we compare values here, we store the old ones, we get the compound tag, we handle it, and handle update tag, yeah, we'll call load client data, and then we see if there's a difference, and if there's any difference, we need to refresh our model data and send a render update. So this same line, when called on the client, will cause a render update. When you do that line on the server, like we do above, it will cause syncing to the client. But this is important. This is for our baked model, which we'll explain in a moment. It will request model data to refresh. Then there's this important method. This is actually used by the baked model, which we will see in a moment. It gets the model data with the four different properties that we want to know in the baked model. The reason that it works like this, and that why can't the baked model directly access the block entity? The reason for that is that the baked model can potentially be generated in a thread, and you don't want to avoid multi-threading problems. You don't want to access the block entity from a different thread, so you also always want to go through this. Okay, so now it's time for our baked model, and for that we need three things, which I will copy. Okay, so it all starts with a model loader. So this is a model loader for our geometry, which is an inner class that's defined here. It has a specific key, we will register it later, with specific name. This loader is responsible for making our baked models. There are different, let me also copy the texture so that that's easier to follow. So basically, let's go over the textures. This is the front side, you know, with this in. This is when it's powered. Again, that's an animated image, so four states. This is for the buttons, for these. And this is for the side of the block, for the other. So these textures, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 textures are what we needed. So if we go back to our loader, that's these 5 textures. And we also define materials from them, because the baked model system works with materials. A material is basically a very simple thing. It's a resource location for the texture and a resource location for the atlas. And let me explain what an atlas is. So this is just something I found on the internet. It's an example of an atlas. Basically, for OpenGL hardware, it's more efficient to have as little textures as possible, because every time you need to change a texture, you need to render the model with a different texture, you need to change context settings, and that's actually expensive. So it's very efficient to combine all textures that you need on a single big texture, and that's called the texture atlas. So this is an example of a texture. You see it contains the vanilla stuff, also some modded stuff from my mods. So that's basically how a texture atlas works. So every material is a combination of an atlas texture, and most of the time use the standard atlas. There are a few other possibilities, but you usually use the standard one and the texture. And this one is just a convenient method to make such a material from our texture. So whenever we need a new model, our model loader is called with this JSON. So you can actually have parameters in your JSON for your model. However, we don't use that. We just create immediate model geometry, which is this class. It specifies which materials we want to use, and it creates the actual baked model. The baked model is responsible for generating the static geometry, but in a dynamic way. So depending on the state, depending on the model properties, this baked model can change. So that's why in the block entity, we have the model data, which we send every time something changes. And then this will be recreated. Basically, recreating means that getQuads will be called again. GetQuads is the thing that returns list of quads. So quads is a rectangle, as it were, which represents a face on a shape on the model. So when getClots is called, you actually get the extra data as a parameter. You also get the block state, the direction which is being rendered. So it's important to note that whenever a block is rendered, this is called 7 times. Once with the side equal to null, representing the entire block, and 6 times for every side. So that way you can decide to, for example, for a block, you would return once quad for every side. And that way Minecraft can better cull those, so remove non-visible quads. And yeah, if you want to do some random stuff, for example, with cobblestone, the texture is sometimes a bit different to not have a repetitive texture, and you can use that. The first thing we do here is check, are we on the solid render type? So solid render type is where all the solid geometry is rendered, and that's also where we want our baked model to render. And if not, and if site is different from null, we only want to render our entire model when the site is null. The other sites we ignore. So then we return the empty list. No quads for that situation. We get the extra data from our model, from, so the data from our extra data, like here. This is a safe way to do it, by the way, because this returns a boolean. So a boolean with a capital B, and it can be null in case the data isn't there yet. And by comparing it with true, you are sure that it will not cause a null pointer exception when downcasting to boolean with the small b. Then it's important, one thing you should always do in a baked model is try to cache your quads, because it's a bit it's hard work to calculate quads, and if you can cache them, that's a big improvement. So that's what we do here. But the quads from our model, remember how our model looked like, they depend on the orientation and also whether some of the buttons are pressed. For example, generating, collecting, and actually generating, because that changes the front page, the front texture. So we have a model key, which is this class, which keeps track of this, and also the model state, which is the transformation. So model state is a representation of our rotation. So the direction will be by Minecraft changed to model state. And these, we make a key. And a key class is basically just keeping these as data and then generating an equals and a hash code. By doing that, you can use this instances of this in a hash map, as a key in a hash map. And that's what we do here. So for a given state of a model, we remember which quads we want to return. So we only generate them once. And we generate that cache in the beginning, so that in the constructors. That's also important because this can be run in threads, and the map is not thread safe. So you want to do this in the constructor. And here we do for all different permutations of the model key. So true, false, false, true, false, true, false, false, true, true. And the model state. So this constructor, this big model will be called for every different model state. So 6 times for the 6 orientations. So we will have six instances of generator baked model, each with their own quad cache with this model state. And we generate quads for that situation. Yeah, we need the client tools. Let's copy that. That's a class I made to make the code a bit cleaner. So client tools basically has a method to create a quad. That's the public method, and some helpers. I will explain these in a moment. But basically what we do here, first we generate, so we first, hold on, let's retract. In the constructor, so we get the model state. By the way, this constructor is called from our loader here, from the geometry actually. So we give to this the things that we get in this parameter that we need. So one is the model state, that's a transformation. Sprite getter is what you use to actually get. Remember that all textures are put on a big atlas. With sprite getter, you can get the actual location on that atlas given a resource location. So we need to remember that because we actually need to render with the correct location on the big atlas. Overrides, that's used for the item model, that's also important so that our item model looks correctly in the inventory. Item overrides and also the item transforms. And item transforms we are also given. So these two are for the items. And then we call the generate cache, quads. So what will this do? This will first create a list of baked quads. Here are some parameters. We get the rotation from the model state transformation, which is basically a 4x4 matrix representing an a transformation. We get our actual sprites. So these are the materials, and you remember that I told you that material is an identifier for an atlas and a texture on that atlas. So these are the textures that we need to use. A texture atlas sprite actually represents the real location on that atlas. So these coordinates are two-dimensional coordinates representing the area on the atlas, on the big atlas, where our smaller texture is located. Using this, we can fill the array of quads with the appropriate quads. So this is the base model. So these sides are fixed. And the front side is using another texture depending of if we are generating or not. So that's the red animated texture that you see then. Then there are the two buttons. So again, five quads because we don't want to render the back of that because we can't see it. And also texture on, texture off. There's a different texture depending on the state. So that's basically this. Yeah. So what we also want to do, so that's done in the constructor. So in when we actually want to get the quads, we first get the quads for the generating block. That's the OR that is inserted in the slot. To do that, we get the generating block from our model data. We check if it's okay. We check if it can render in this layer, in the solid layer. We get, for ORs that will always be the case, we check, we get the baked model, and then we rotate it so that it is scaled down and put in the top left quadrant of our big block. That's what this transform does. It's a bit complicated, but basically this one will, depending on the transformation of our block, calculate where the little block will have to go. So it will make a new translation matrix, a scale matrix, and another translation matrix. It's a bit hard to explain this. This is somewhat complicated. I spent a lot of time making this. There are comments here. I'm not going to go into too much detail. It's rather technical, but you can try. Basically, the transforms, you have to look at it in reverse. So first we translate half a block. Then we rotate and scale it. Rotation from our own main block. And then scale. Then we translate back with these locations. Okay. So we make a new quad transformer from that. And actually, this can be put here. That's more efficient. It's always the same transformer. We don't have to do it every time. For all sides of the block, we get the quads and we add it to our list of quads. So that will be this. We get the model key, and from our cache we append the quads from our own model. So the combined list will be the list from the block that we are generating and our own model. So yeah, that's basically it. So client tools, it takes the four corners of the quad, the transformation and the sprite. It calculates the normal, that's the vector that is perpendicular to this face. It gets the width and the height of the texture. It transforms the normal according to the rotation. It transforms the four coordinates, and then it actually makes a quad. Set quad orientation, put the four vertices of that quad. And this is some code that you can use for that. So to put a vertex on the baked quad builder, you have to follow the rules from the actual current vertex format. That's why you do it this way. So can be a position, but we don't know, can be a color and so on. That's basically how this works. We also have to register our model loader so that we know it. And we do that in client setup. We want this to be in an event. And that means our client setup also has to be an event listener for our mod on the client side for the mod event bus. And when there is a model registry event, that's when the appropriate time to register these loaders. So with the loader identifier and an instance of our loader. So that's basically it. Now we need to actually use this model loader for our block, and for that we will also use data generation. So let me set that up. So let's first add a new method. It's actually a lot simpler than before because there's not much JSON to generate. So basically we make a model builder for our block. We give the standard cube from vanilla as a parent. That's important so that our item has the correct transformation. This makes sure that the transforms are correct for the item in your hand or in your inventory. And then we define a custom loader. Custom loader builder, block model builder, generator loader. This is the identifier of our loader. And we just pass along the parameter that we get here to it. So there's not much more to it. There's nothing in it inside it. It's very simple. And that's the model. And then we make a directional block. Directional block means a block that has six orientations. It will use the facing property for our generator for this model. That's all you have to do for this. We also have to add our generator to the mineable and tool things tags. We have to add an item model like this, just a parent with an existing parent. And there are no item tags. There's language provider. Like this. Like this. Okay. And then the loot tables. That's a standard table again, because we also want to remember the inventory and the power that it has. And then recipe. So you see, once you have done this, it's actually pretty easy. So that should be it. So let's generate that. So there were no errors. So let's add the new things to it. Let's check how the block state looks now that it's, yeah, it just refers to the model with the six facings, the six orientations. And in the model, this is very simple. We set the Minecraft cube parent, as we told, for the item, and we have a loader. So that's all it is. It's possible if your loader would have had JSON parameters, you could actually put more stuff in there for the parameters for our model, but we don't need that. Let's try it out. I think we have everything. Yeah, let's try it out. Okay, let's see if we made any mistakes. So we have the generator like this. Let's put it next to this one. So it's immediately getting power from this, and the buttons work. So let's sheet in some ingots. As soon as you press the collecting button, yeah, they get collected. And now we start generating. Yes, something there is wrong. Let me check out what's going on. Hold on. Yeah, nothing is wrong. I forgot to set the thing on that items are not, that you don't need the one to have the probe in your hand to see items. So it still has the ingots, but it isn't generating, so something is wrong. So let's debug it. Let's see what we missed. The easiest way to do this is just go to the tick server, put a breakpoint there, and let's see what is going on. Okay, generate ores. Oh yeah, of course. User error. Diamond ore. I want to generate diamond ores. Now it's working. I forgot to set this. That's it, basically. So this is working. Now we want to generate the special effect above this block. So a baked model represents the static geometry. Now we want to do really dynamic geometry. Most of the time, you actually want static geometry because that's more efficient. But there are situations where dynamic is better or the only way. So we have a texture here, a special star texture. And let's add a render. So this is a block entity renderer. First we have our texture, which we actually, so in contrast with the model loader, because we specified the textures we needed, Minecraft knew that it had to put those textures on the atlas For renders, that's not the case, so you have to manually put them on the atlas. And that happens also in an event in client setup, which is the texter stitch event.pre. So first, this is called for every atlas that we have. So first we check that we are on the right atlas with this, and then we add our texture. This will cause our texture to be put on the atlas. That's also why we want pre, so it's put there before, so it's surely put on the atlas. Okay. The render itself is pretty simple. Basically, we get the powered property from our block state. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention, in this baked model, notice how you get the block state, you get the model data, but you don't get the position of the block. That's on purpose. You are not allowed to access the world here to get the block entity or whatever. That's why there is model data. Here it's a bit different. You can actually, you get the block entity, so you can directly access that. So that's easy. And from the block entity, you get the block state. You also get the position from that. So this is a bit more flexible in that regards. That's just how this is. We check if powered is true. If not, we just return. We render nothing. Otherwise, we have a slight animation effect depending on the current time, so that the star is pulsating. We get the sprite, the actual sprite from our atlas. And then we use the post stack. I will have rendering tutorials later explain this in more detail, but basically this represents the transformation to camera space, from world to camera space, that's currently in use for or wherever the player is standing. And when you modify that, you also always have to remember that. So first you push, and at the end you pop, and then you can make modifications to that. So we translate first to the middle of the block and one higher, so our star will appear up top. We get the main camera rotation, and we multiply that with our post stack, and that will make sure because we are going to make a single quad, that our single quad is always facing the camera. That's what these two lines do. Then we get a buffer on which we can put our vertices for a custom render type that I still have to define. Also, this will be explained in more detail later, but basically, this is a render type that uses additive blending. So our texture will be added to the world, to the rendering. Okay. Then we make our actual quad. There's also a register method, and we have to call that. And we call that again in client setup in this location. That should be it. Let's try it out. All right, so it's not correctly working. Let's get some calls. So the texture isn't loading, and we will try to find out why that is. So in the log, unable to load file not found textures effect hello. I thought I copied it, textures effect hello. Let me check out what's wrong. All right, now it's working. I just had to rebuild. For some reason, the texture wasn't copied to the build folder. So this is, when it's generating power, it will show that. Note that it's not perfect. Hold on. Let's go to creative. You see how it doesn't blend correctly with itself. And in future tutorials, we will provide solutions for that. For now, it's just a small artifact. But note, so the difference between this and this, this is a static model. Unless you change something, it's not re-rendered. The quads are cached and are made part of the chunk. Same with this, even though the texture is animating, this is made part of the chunk. However, this is rendered every frame, every time. It's dynamic. And sometimes that's good. If you have something that animates, that changes every frame, also note how it rotates to fit with the camera. That's something you can't do with a baked model. It needs to be dynamic. So that's a choice you have to make.